brand new episode of Sparks Entertainment and Art, where we explore, among many other things, the great connection between the fans of the band Sparks and the band itself. One thing that fascinates me, as you know, is that everyone has a different perspective when they think about this band, and I love capturing these stories. And I'm really happy today because we are traveling to Norway and we are talking with Tor Harald. And Tor is someone who has thought about and written about the compositional aspect of Sparks' music and how Ron Mael goes about creating the songs that he does. And that's an interesting take. We talk about the lyrics a lot and we talk about Russell a lot, but today we're going to mention all those things in the context of the compositions of the songs and how Ron Mael makes the wonderful arrangements that give us so much joy and pleasure. Tor, is that a good introduction?
Tor? Yes, thank you, and thanks for having me.
Well, absolutely. I'm very happy to have you. And you are also a member of a tribute band that is just starting up called Sparksify, that is playing Sparks' music, and we'll hear more about that. And you've also been active on Facebook. You have a Facebook group dedicated to Ron Mael and his songwriting. So these are very exciting things, and I'm really happy to have you. And my first question to you, sir, is how did you get into Sparks, and what made them so special to you when you heard them?
Actually, it was through my sister. She was 16. She came home from England with propaganda under her arm, and I was 5 years old. And when Achoo, the song, went playing, of course, it was very funny for a five-year-old boy. And since then, Sparks has been a great part of my life. But at the time, as a five-year-old, I also fell in love with songs like Something for the Girl with Everything. So it was not just for fun.
No, but it was the energy, I guess, that for as a five-year-old that caught your attention.
Yeah. Yeah, and creativity. Who had ever heard an album first at you in the as a chorus and several times in the end?
Yeah, and when you listened to it at five, though, you heard it a lot different than when you heard it at 15, say, or over the years, right?
Right.
Yeah, and please.
Of course, the emotions towards an album. When I listen to music, I can choose to listen to music in three ways. Either I can just dive in and enjoy and have a good time, I can be a little bit analytical. And as far as I've learned a bit of music, I've been more able to do that when, and very. I get much out of that as well, because when you play a song on a piano alone without a great production, you really get to hear the harmonies and get to realize, wow, it's not using the chord progressions that are used in thousands of songs. It's like he says in his songwriting formula, never use a major song when a diminished chord or an augmented chord could do just as well.
Well, you're referring to Ron's list of songwriting rules, right? And that's, yeah. Do you feel that those rules are things that he actually adheres to, or do you think they were meant humorously or somewhere in between?
I think both. Yes, they are funny, at least to me as an amateur musician, like the one that says, never write a song in the key of A. That's funny. Why shouldn't you? When I gave it some thought, I thought, okay, if on the early records where Ron perhaps didn't arrange the songs that much, but he left some space for the musicians to arrange their parts. If you tell a guitar player this song goes in A, it would be easy for him to do something. He's played so many times in A, but if you ask him to play in C sharp minor, he would, what do you know? I never played in this scale. So he'd be forced to be creative, do something he'd never done before.
So you've made a lot of interesting points already, and we've only been talking for a couple minutes. And just to follow up on that last one, does Ron write the songs as he hears them in his head and wants them to sound, as opposed to thinking, here's what will be a constraint for the band, or here's what will be easy for the band to play, so I want to write it in that key?
Very difficult to say, because later on, I think he decides all of the arrangements. I think when he used the guitar player on Latta, I don't think he was given much freedom to decide what to play on the guitar. In the concerts where with one guitar player playing the keyboard parts that are impossible to play by one musician.
Yeah.
I think Ron might have said to the guitar player, don't use seventh chords, or fill in with some sevenths when there is a little space in the song where there should have been another keyboard. Yes.
When was it you started to listen to their music and take an analytical approach to it in terms of what you were hearing? Obviously not when you were five.
Well, perhaps then. Also because there has always been music where I grew up. A lot of Beethoven, like Ron likes. So I would say gradually throughout the years, but as I got better to play songs and write songs, I got more and more analytical.
Mm-hmm. So your own musical background with listening to classical music, as well as your instrumentation yourself, taking it up, got you to start listening to these songs in a different way.
Yeah, I think so. And not just Beethoven at home, but my older sisters, 11 year older and 7 year older, they brought me lots of impulses. So, what do I hear there? What do I hear there? And what did they do there? And
yeah. Well, you mentioned a chew. So another song from that album that you also mentioned when we were preparing for the show, sticking to that album for the moment, was At Home, At Work, At Play. And what do you hear? How do you hear that song in terms of the songwriting? interested in your thoughts.
Yeah, when we started to try and nail the Sparks song for the tribute band, Sparksify, we were really surprised of all the subtle nuances in the songs all over the place. We first rehearsed This Town Are Big Enough. We noticed that the intro theme, if you might call it that, sometimes it's three times, two times, four times. But then at home at work at play, nothing is like a songwriter would do. It would define themes in a song, and okay, now we'll put this theme there, and we put this theme there, and perhaps add a little or remove something. But here, the intro theme in At Home at Work at Play, At Home at Work at Play, it's performed different each time in the song. I think four times it comes in the song. In the middle, it works not as an intro, but as middle play, something that lasts. It goes in three speeds. So that theme changes importance or what it actually stands for throughout the song. And then there is these stops where Russell's voice perhaps sounds like an instrument, like it gets quiet, but you hear stop, there's gonna be a million girls here now, but I can't think of one. So we realized that the song was extremely difficult to sing for anyone. So we noticed several nuances, and then as we rehearsed the other songs, we noticed all the way there were far too more nuances than in even a creative pop song. So that gives a lot of tongue-in-cheek, took us some time, and was very funny to rehearse.
Yeah, and I think that's a great example. And you mentioned his use of Russell as an instrument almost. And I think another song that you mentioned to me earlier was Under the Table with Her, where you also heard that.
Misses diminutive offspring, not when there's big wigs there, there. Dinner for 12 is now dinner for 10, 'cause I'm under the table with her.
So there's a songwriter would come with something. Okay, we'll follow these chords, and we'll do it this way. We'll put in some keyboard there, some brass there, or something like, and the rest of the albums. But there is only a little bit of fiddle throughout the song, mostly fiddle, which actually isn't a typical Sparks instrument anyway. But so the whole song is not a cappella, but it's driven all along with Russell's voice as an instrument, playing a rather fast melody like someone would on a piano.
And on Indiscreet in particular, he really experimented a lot. He kind of broke out of the mold from the first two British albums and really experimented a lot with his songwriting as well as the songs themselves. Is that a fair statement?
Well, actually, to a certain degree, I think so. But I think Tony Visconti, the producer, has much to say for that album. Because if you try and imagine Giorgio Moroder producing Indiscreet, it would sound totally different. And if Number One in Heaven was produced by Tony Visconti, it would be a completely different album. So production has a lot to do with it. So I
love that point. And, you know, I think just thinking about each of the different producers and what they brought to the albums is something that's pretty pretty interesting to me, particularly in the later years when they produced their own. They decided to go a completely different route.
Yeah, so that's, I think that's nice that they do it by themselves and not leave the songs totally to other producers, because interesting, I think the difference in production may be a major reason why Sparks have gathered new fans throughout the years, because with only a few exceptions, the productions have been very different from album to album. Think about big beats, suddenly rock and roll, and production has a lot to do with how you get into a band, I think.
Yeah. But you're bringing a really interesting perspective, because generally the way I always thought of it was that they wanted to do something different, so they found the producer that would help them realize their vision. But what you're saying are you saying the same thing, or are you saying something a little different?
No, perhaps both. I'm totally sure Ron Mael went into the studio and said something funny, but with a meaning. I want this, this, like this and that, and just go ahead, make it as pull it as far as possible. But like the Number One in Heaven album, they had said for a joke that we'll have Giorgio Moroder produce the album, and that was because they idolized him. They wanted an album like that. Mm-hmm. Ron had thought of it as going to be sounding like a Velvet Underground album, the songs were that kind, but the album certainly it doesn't sound like the Velvet Underground.
No, that wouldn't be the right producer for that sound.
Yeah. No, but it is. Can I just mention one thing? Perhaps I mentioned it earlier, but when I sit by myself, play something from Indiscreet, something from Number One in Heaven, by myself, only the piano, you hear more of the signature that Ron has. You hear a clearer signature, but still, even though you hear a signature like many songwriters have, you still notice that with this pen, he is so hugely creative. There's no limits. It's like when I first listened to some Beethoven pieces, I was thinking, what has he smoked when he wrote these sonatas? And so when I play Ron's songs with naked, only piano, I'm thinking Ron must have, because you can't escape from your signature, so he must have said to himself, okay, but don't do it like Ron Mael would have done it. He might have said to himself.
He does. He is amazingly creative, isn't he? I mean, it's amazing what he does. When I was researching for this episode, I found a great quote from Russell, who said, he was asked about the process, and he said, the general process is Ron writes the music, and then Ron writes the lyrics, and then I go, God, that's really good.
Just like in the video, you know, the My Way video, where Ron sits in front of the piano and Russell looks at the sheets. And I believe it totally.
Oh, that's one of their best videos, in my humble opinion. That's a perfect video.
Yeah. And I think so too.
Yeah. And I want to pull on a thread that you started to hint at, which is about Latte. To me, Latte is a very special album, and I'm still organizing my thoughts about that. And one of the things that I hear in that is a transition, because, you know, they never like to stick with any style more than two or three albums. And I hear a lot of transition, and I'm starting to articulate in my mind what that transition is, because it's not a clear break from pop music, but it does break from Hippopotamus and Drip, 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 in my opinion. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are about that. Do you hear a change in Latte compared to those two albums from the production side of things and the sound of the album and how the arrangements are?
Oh, definitely the production. And I'm sure they wanted to make a 2023 album, not trying to copy themselves. Any serious artist would want to keep up with time and go ahead. So I think this songwriting is inventive yet modern, and they've stayed clear of things like the EDM drums, cymbals, and autotune. You don't need autotune. Russell wouldn't need autotune.
He still sings live in the same key that the songs were written in 40 years ago. So he's probably good on the autotune front.
Yes, this is, they use autotune, also lots of autotune, even for vocalists that sing marvelous. Pavarotti, they would have, but they are true to themselves.
But I want to get back to this point that I'm asking about, because when you hear Drip, Drip, Drip in Hippopotamus, they're coming from a certain place, from a very pop place, and this album is also, but it's different. And from your perspective, listening to it from a technical, compositional perspective, if you agree with that, how would you describe what makes this one a little different? It's not a clear break, but it's definitely still, in my mind, at least a little different.
I think it's more experimental. It's not as easy to for every listener to comprehend. It demands more from the listener. It's more, you need to dive into it more than a Hippopotamus or a steady drip. You need to, what's happening here? And also you need to try and be, feel the suggestivity. There's something and not changing too much. It's subtle changes, like in the latter song, where the, you know, comes more and more and more. And then there comes a crazy synth sound, which actually sounds like a guitar. It could be, I know there is guitars in albums, but that's a synth. And that's actually, I find a similarity to, thank God it's not Christmas, okay? And if it, the album had been from 1974, it would be, you know, the guitar solos. But this is 2023, let's do it with a synth.
It seems to me that hip, and this is really in the weeds, so a lot of people might roll their eyes at this, but it seems to me that Hippopotamus and Drip 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 were recorded thinking about how they would be played with a band for most, not always, but for the for a lot of it. Whereas this one was thought of, it came from what do we, Ron and Russell, want to do? And then where does it make sense to augment the band? Does that make any sense, or am I thinking about it too hard?
Oh, I think that's a very good point, and I totally agree.
Yeah. And let's talk about one song on there, because I've had a lot of discussion with folks about the song It's Sunny Today. And I know you've thought about the contrasting impressions one gets from the music and the lyrics sometimes. And when I hear that song, I hear those kind of positive lyrics from Russell, but I hear his delivery as being kind of somber, and I hear the music is very downcast. And from a technical point of view, I'm wondering your thoughts about that. But do you hear the song that way, or is this just an interpretation that's, you know, in one of many?
I'm not sure that I have heard the song the same way, but when I go but there, I think, yes, perhaps in as a conscious thing, as an effect, and then I would possibly think of it as a way of exaggerating the lyrical point by making the contrast bigger than usual, since it's not a common thing for Sparks to do. Also, I would think of Sparks as, you know, Morrissey had Sparks as idols, Morrissey from the Smiths, Lighten Up Morrissey.
Sure.
And that band was full of these, all of the songs were like that. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a great irony that is exaggerated.
It's an irony in that song. It's a lot of irony.
Yeah, I mean, the irony is between the mood in the lyrics and in the music.
Yeah, yeah. That's I agree with you. I have a lot of thoughts about that album. I think it's one of their best, one of their absolute top best albums, personally. So there's one other aspect, I could talk all day, but the one other aspect that fascinates me about their production and how he writes is the classical influence. And you mentioned Beethoven a couple times, and you mentioned your own training and how that influenced you. Do you hear that? And I can think of many songs where I hear that, and they use classical instrumentation a lot, but I'm just wondering what your thoughts are about that particular aspect.
Well, I'm a rather mediocre keyboard player, but sometimes I have to force myself to slowly learn a piece from sheet music, because I just want to play it right. And so this way, like, you get to know, like, Beethoven. And when you hear I Married Myself, you get to realize that the first chords in the song are precisely the same as the ones in Beethoven's Pathetique. And this is on the little Beethoven album. So that's, and but the fascinating thing for me is that, you know, Beethoven never made a vocal line to it. So Ron asks, which lyric suits this song and how should it be sung? Because the chord changes there aren't common.
Yeah, wow, that's amazing. Do you have other examples like that where you can really hear the classical influence? And the one that comes to my mind is always as I sit down to play the organ at the Notre Dame Cathedral, which to me is just a class, but of course it goes all the way back, but that's one that really stands out to me as having a classical influence. Do you agree, or am I hearing it right?
I would say parts of the song. I would say that the song has lots of genres mixed together, and I love mixing of genres. I think it's a very, very, very creative song, and I think yes, certainly it's a good classical inspiration, and of course, church organ enhances that impression.
Well, he doesn't really use a traditional song structure very often. He did it in the 80s, and he did it once in a while elsewhere, but he really, why does he doesn't really embrace a typical pop song structure, does he?
And yet he gets popular.
Yeah.
Well, I think perhaps it's because it's the creativity often is a bit hidden. You have to dive into it, but if you don't dive into it, you get some kind of tongue in cheek when you hum to the song or something. You know, no, that doesn't fit. It should be that note, but it isn't that note. So I think that might be the reason, perhaps.
Yeah. Well, he doesn't always make it easy, but on the other hand, if you keep listening and working at it, you get a great reward. I said he doesn't always make it easy, but if you keep listening at it and listening to it and working at it, you get a great reward.
Oh, yeah. And of course, you don't have to be analytical when you listen to music. That would be terrible if you couldn't listen to music without analyzing the music. You need to let it hit your heart and or your back and just be, sit down and enjoy the music. But it's also fascinating to try and understand the reason why you do it this way with sparks, unlike you would with Taylor Swift, whom, with all respect, I would say has some recipes that
sure
she picks. Yeah,
but he doesn't have recipes. Yeah, so
yeah. Not at all.
Yeah.
Oh, but no, Ron Mael.
Do you find that often? Well, go ahead. You're saying something, and I interrupted. I'm sorry.
I would say Ron always makes up his recipes. Always, never ever tricks from any book. I think he once said it, perhaps in the Sparks Brothers movie, that that would be the greatest loss for them if they had to try and be somebody else than they are.
Yeah.
And yet they get popular, yet they get so many people throughout so many years, so many different people to like them.
Do you often find that at first when you listen to the album, it doesn't, it's inconclusive of what your impression is inconclusive, but as you listen to it more and more, all of a sudden it starts to gel as a holistic piece of work?
Yeah, certainly. It's hard to describe, and it, you know, it differs between albums, and I think it's a great thing when it grows and grows and you don't get it instantly.
Yeah, I agree.
I think Latta will be that kind of album for lots of Sparks fans.
I agree with you completely. Tor, you've been more than generous with your time, so I want to thank you. Any final thoughts on all of these things that you want to convey?
When I listen to all that, the song All That, I'm thinking of Ron writing that song should be played in. I think it's so from the heart. It makes me so, it hits me so bad. I think the song has to be about our two lovely men.
It's about their connection to the fans. I agree. Just like we look at the fans' connection to them, maybe that gives us some insight into their connection to the fans. I hadn't thought about that.
Yeah, perhaps.
So glad you raised that song. It's such a great song.
Yeah, it's so beautiful. Yeah.
Yeah.
The
first few times I listened to it, I would well up every time. I would start to tear up a little bit.
Yeah. And that album, you know, there in that my impression was that in that album every single got better than the first, better and better, and then we got the album and wow, all that, oh Jesus Lord, it's so nice, so beautiful.
That's great. It's great. This has been a great conversation, and Tor, I want to thank you so much for your time and for talking with us on the Sparks Entertainment and Arts show. It was wonderful.
Yeah, thank you very much.
All right. And I want to say to everyone watching, thank you. We really love it. We love growing this community. As I've mentioned before, we have an email address if you want to get in touch or join the show. We'd love to hear from you. But on that note, I think we will say goodbye till next time. Tor, thank you again.
Bye.
All right. See you soon, everybody. Until next time, I'm signing off.